Hello everyone, I'm Sushmita Sarkar, Assistant Professor in Triple Department, RV College of Engineering. I welcome you all for today's lecture 5 on transient overvoltages. So in today's lecture, we will be learning about sources of transient overvoltages, and believe me, you will really enjoy today's lecture. Fine, so in this particular lecture, what we are going to learn, we are going to learn about the concept of transients and the different types of transients. Fine, so when we talk about the transients are the basically, we are talking about the source of transients. So they can be talked in terms of internal and external. So in this throughout lecture, we will learn about what are the internal transients and what is external transients. What are the main sources of internal and external transients, basically, right? So when I talk about a capacitor switching operation, this comes under internal transients, fine? So we will be learning about what are these capacitor switching operation and what is this magnification of capacitor switching transients. Fine, so you can see this is a picture I have put it so that you can better understand how these capacitors look in your transmission lines. So you can see this transmission, and just let me take the pointer. So you can see this capacitors, you know, and why do we need capacitors? I hope all of you are very much clear with your basics that why do I require a capacitor into my system, into power system? Fine, so capacitors are required. What they do basically, they inject, they provide your reactive power in order to provide what? A better power factor so that your losses are reduced. Fine. So we'll be learning more about these kind of effect when these capacitors are turned on into the system. Fine. Next, we will see lightning strike location. So when I talk about a lightning strike locations and the associated power quality problems related to them, is mainly coming under the external source of transients, fine? So to start with, so we will be seeing, because lightning, you know, we have seen a lot of, you would have seen a lot of videos and how does the impact of lightning on the system. And you know that always a highest point, where does the lightning strikes? And we will also learn exactly what are these points and where we should provide these lightning arrestors, okay? So let us start with the concept of transient. So you know, transient is something which is going to occur for a very short duration, as the name says, transient. Fine, so this duration may be for few nanoseconds to few milliseconds. And these are basically going to have a very high magnitude of voltages and currents. Fine, so they are very high. They're very, in that short duration, the impact is very huge, you know, basically. So these may reach up to 1000 volts or amperes, even when we are talking about low voltage section of the power system. Fine, so these are basically, as I told you, this is existing for a very short duration, for a few nanoseconds to few milliseconds. Fine, so as I said, the duration is very short. So based on that, I can say this is the shortest among all the PQ problems. Fine, but what is the other impact we have of these transients is that they have abnormal frequencies which can go up to 5 megahertz, you know, so the frequencies just go abruptly too high. So what we, in a short, what I have understood by a transient, transients is something which is going to happen for a very short time, and this transient may occur in your system internally due to the internal causes or due to external reasons. Fine, but they are going to happen for a very short duration, but will have a very high magnitude of voltage, current, as well as a very abnormal frequency ranges. Fine, so what are the different types of transients? So basically, when we talk about a transient, we come across the two terms, which is called as impulsive transients and oscillatory transients. So what are these impulsive transients? So these particular transients are characterized by the rate of change of voltages or currents, which means I'm talking about rise or fall time of the current or voltage. Basically, this type of impulsive transients are, you know, they are unidirectional, fine? So they will have either the positive peak or the negative peak. So when I talk about a lightning strike, So they comes under a impulsive transient. So the another type which we talk about mainly is the oscillatory transients. So oscillatory transients are basically characterized with the keeping the frequency in mind and the duration in mind, right? So these are unidirectional. So you can see the positive, negative peak both, right? So they happen in both the directions. And the example for such kind of transients are your capacitor switching. So to be more precise about the definition of impulsive transient, as per IEEE 1159, that it is a sudden non-power frequency change in the steady state condition of voltage, current, or both. That is unidirectional in polarity. So that's what I told you. This kind of transients will have, you will see either a positive peak of voltage, current, or negative peak of voltage and current, or both. Fine, both may get affected by these kind of transients. So these are normally a single very high impulse like a lightning. Fine, so in this particular graph, you can see a negative peak. So this is a typical current impulsive transient caused by lightning. And based on the duration, they can be categorized as in an order of nanoseconds, in an order of milliseconds, or an microseconds. Nano, micro, or milliseconds, you can categorize them, and their duration, which is less than 50 nanoseconds, they comes under a nanosecond impulsive transients. Between 50 to 1 milliseconds, it is 50 nanoseconds to 1 millisecond comes under a microseconds impulsive transients. And similarly, more than 1 millisecond comes under a millisecond impulsive transients. And all these are having different spectral contents. Fine. So now coming to an oscillatory transients, as I told you, the example of oscillatory transients, nothing but capacitor switching. So where we see some places the capacitors are fixed, you need not to turn on or turn off, but in some places based on the loads, you need to turn on or turn off. So in that case, we see such kind of transients. So they are basically defined as a sudden non-power frequency change in steady state condition of voltage, current, or both. Okay, that has both the positive and negative polarity values. That means they are bidirectional. So when I look at the particular switching characteristics and I take a load current characteristics and a voltage characteristic, so you can see, you can observe that whenever the capacitor is getting switched, you can see the positive and negative peak both, and it takes some time to come back to its steady state. So this is what we are talking about, the period which we are calling it as an oscillatory transients. So similarly, just like your impulsive transients, oscillatory transients are also categorized by keeping the duration in mind. Fine. So for a different duration, as you can see in this table, as per a different duration, we classify these transients into a low frequency, medium frequency, and high frequency. So the frequency varies. You can also see that typically the voltage magnitude, which goes from as high as 4 per unit, 8 per unit, and all. Fine. So what are the sources of these transient overvoltages? So as I told you in the beginning, there can be internal source and external source. So internal source, basically, we do have the main sources of transients. It can happen either due to a capacitor switching, or because capacitor switching comes under the internal. It can happen due to a lighting, which is an external. It can also happen due to your resonance characteristics, fine? So these are the, or due to some type of faults which is happening into your system. So these are all causes of transients, but the basic two main important transient which we need to discuss is your capacitor switching and lightning strikes, fine? So these are the two main source of your transients. So in this particular lecture, we are going to talk about only these two sources. So some power electronic devices, yes, apart from this, what happens? Some power devices generate significant transients when they turn on. Fine. So transient overvoltages can be generated at higher frequencies. When I talk about higher frequency, I'm talking about the load switching or the lightning. And it can also happen in a medium frequency or low frequency, which I'm talking basically talking about the capacitor energization system. Fine. So now when I talk about the capacitor switching, so capacitor switching is one of the most common switching events on utility system. So because you need to turn on switched the capacitors on based on the load levels. So they will, the question comes, why do I need to energize the capacitors? What is the importance of capacitors into the system? So you, as I told you in the beginning of the lectures, the importance of the capacitor is what? Yes, to improve the power factor. And how do I do that? I'm going to provide a reactive power in order to improve the power factor so that losses are reduced. And also this particular phenomenon, also this particular capacitor supports the system voltage. Fine. So these are the very important points which we should remember why we are using the capacitors into the system. They are very economical. They are less maintenance, very economical, trouble-free, and it is going, we are going to continue the use of this capacitor comparative to, you know, capacitor to improve the power factor into the system. This is the best method we find out, because other methods are also there, but they are costlier and requires more maintenance. Fine. So as I just now I talked about, the alternative methods are also there. So as for an example, rotating machines, you have electronic volt ampere reactive compensators, but they are pretty costly and they need a very high maintenance. You have to pay a lot for the maintenance cost also. Fine. Thus, the use of capacitors on power system is a common procedure and it is going to be continued to be so. But what is the drawback? So when we talk about the use of capacitors, the major drawback is that they inject an oscillatory transient, you know, so when you turn on, so there we see an oscillatory transient across the system. Fine. So some capacitors are energized all the time, but few capacitors turn on a day based on the load levels. So there are various controls means. So the question comes, how do I control these, you know, transients which are happening. So you have the various controls means, which include your temperature, you know, the time, the voltage, current, the reactive power. These all are used to determine when the capacitor has to be turned on. So it is a common control. It is a common way to control whether you take a two parameter or more than two parameter. Okay, so such that this as a temperature, for an example, as a temperature with a voltage override. So you can use two or three functions together as a mean of controlling. So one of the common symptoms of power quality, yeah. So one of the major symptoms which we see, a very pretty common factor which we see at the utility sector is that these switching surges are occurring at the same time of the day, you know, and why it is happening like that. If I say there is the same time of the day, we are experiencing the same kind of oscillatory transients. What is the reason behind that? That is, the reason is the feeders or the big industry people, what they do is they have some kind of time setting. They just set the time that at this particular time, the capacitor has to turn on, because by the what they estimate, the load is going to be increased. You know, so there's some kind of estimation which says that at this particular time, load is going to be increased. So at that time, the time will be set and automatically it will be turned on. So based on that, they see that every day, the same time, almost these transients are happening. Fine. So yes, this line, particular line talks about that. On distribution feeders with industrial loads, capacitors are frequently switched by time clock in anticipation of an increase in load with the beginning of the working day. So you have already anticipated today this at so and so timing load is going to increase or decrease. Fine. So if you are able to anticipate that timing, you are going to put that timing into your capacitor, you know, to control the capacitor switching, and automatically at that particular timing daily, the utility sector sees that there is an switching surges are happening. So now what happens with this kind of turning or switching on the capacitors? We see that there are a lot of the problem with the ASDs that they trip, and a lot of electronic equipments gets malfunctioned. Okay, so even without noticeable, even without, within a few seconds, these all things happens. So now there's a common example which has been shown over here. You have a substation, you have a monitor location where you are monitoring the, you know, the all the switching surge, what is happening when you turn on the switching capacitor and all. So, and you have, this is your line, you know, this is your feeder altogether, the line impedance. So what exactly happening when you turn on or turn off your capacitor at this end will be monitored at this particular end. So what we see, so here at the monitoring location, this kind of output is observed. What does it mean? So if you look at the output over here, exactly this is the point when the voltage reaches at peak, the capacitor is turned on. So what happens when the capacitor is turned on? Immediately you can see the voltage shoots up, fine. So the voltage is shooting up approximately, it's supposed to maintain at 1 per unit, but it goes up approximately as the, it has been noticed in the monitoring location that it goes around 1.34 or 134, fine. So you can see it's written over typical utility capacitor switching transients reaching 134% voltage observed upline from the capacitor. So upline means nothing but you're connecting the capacitor. As soon as you switch the capacitor, the voltage goes from 1 per unit to 1.34 per unit, and you see the same pattern. That is called as a ringing. You know, the terminology we use is ringing. So it uses the same pattern, and it takes some time to stabilize, and then it comes. So this, because this happens for a few seconds, you know, few milliseconds to nanoseconds, that is what we call the duration is very small, and so we call them as a transient. So this is what you are seeing. It's both happening, the positive peak as well as the negative peak. So that is why we call them as a bidirectional. So here, when we talk about a system, this system can go up to this peak can go up to between one to, you know, between, it can reach up to 1 to 3 units, 3 units or 4 units, can depends on your damping, system damping capacity, fine. So that is what it's all talk about. So when we read about it, you know, so in this particular case, the capacitor switch contacts close at the point near to the system voltage peak. That's what I'm telling you. Exactly when your voltage is at the peak, the capacitor gets turned on. So due to that, you can feel that the sudden rise in voltage. So this is a common occurrence for many types of switches because the insulation across the switch tends to break down. And that is the reason you see that, that this kind of voltage across a switch is at a maximum value. Fine. Now, whenever you are turning on the switch at this particular point, you will see the voltage across the capacitor is found to be zero. Okay. You should never forget the definition of capacitor, because whenever we ask a definition of the capacitor, students usually answer as, you know, that it is a storing devices. So my question is, this capacitor is also storage devices, inductor is also storage devices, but they store at a different field. You know, but when you have to define a capacitor, the perfect definition of a capacitor says that it opposes the rate of change of voltage, fine? So it will not allow the sudden change in the voltage. So keeping that thing in mind, initially the capacitor, actually when you turn on the capacitor, is at that instant should be zero. But when you see the same voltage, try to read the same voltage from the monitoring end, you will find there is a certain voltage drop. So there will be the drop. The voltage may not show you at the monitoring end at zero, but it will show a certain dip in the voltage. And that comes due to that feeder impedance, which is connected between your monitoring location and at the capacitor end. Okay. So because the power system source is inductive, your source is inductive. So therefore, the capacitor voltage overshoots. That's the reason the capacitor voltage gets overshoots and rings at the natural frequency of the system. I already explained you what do you mean by rings, you know. So at the monitoring location shown, the initial change in voltage will not go to completely zero, as I told you, because the impedance between the observation point and the capacitor, there is a feeder impedance which is lying in between these two points. However, there will be, you can see, an initial drop and subsequent ringing transients that is indicative of that the capacitor is turned on. Okay. The overshoot will generate a transient. Yes, when you talk about as soon as you turn on the capacitor, there is an overshoot that takes place. So this overshoot may go up to 1 to 2 per unit depending on the system damping. Okay. For certain systems, even it goes up to 3 to 4 units also, per unit also, okay? So in this case, the transient observed. So in this typical case, which I have shown you the example, and I've already told about the magnitude which is observed at the monitoring station is around 1.344 per unit. But usually at this kind of, you know, the utility capacitor site switching will always give you this increase in voltage will be usually 1.3 to 1.4 per unit. Fine. So switching, yes. Now the switching, if the switching happens at the star grounded, you know, the transformer of three phase, and if the connection of the transformer is star grounded, then that may also result in unusual transient voltages in the local grounding system due to the current surges due to the energization of your capacitor. So if you have a transformer which is star grounded, there also such kind of transients are seen. So now here I'm taking one typical case. Here in this case, we talk about there is a phase current observed whenever you are switching the capacitor, you are turning on the capacitor. What happens? The phase current is observed, and you can see how the phase current has shown a drastically increase and goes up to 4 units. So as I told you, there are many systems, many turning on capacitors will take the system even to 4 times. Fine. So here I'm not talking in terms of per unit, I'm talking about ampere. So you will say the 4 times of the load currently, just you can see the shoot up. Fine. So that's why we say if there is a certain cases where the current shoot up drastically 4 times the load current. So these are happening due to the turning on of the capacitors. Now the question comes, magnification of capacitor switching transients. How do I go about this magnification of capacitor switching transients? So what we see is the potential side effect of adding power factor correction. So as we have already discussed, see, you want to add a capacitor in order to improve the power factor. But you also know with the addition of capacitor, the transients will also come. Okay, they will also inject a transients to your end user equipments. So we should have, and we have seen that there's always a brief voltage transfer which is lying between 1.3 to 1.4 per unit, which we have seen already. So these transients are generally higher. Yeah, so your transients may go more than 2 per unit. Chances are there when your capacitor banks are not grounded. So if your capacitor banks are not properly grounded, the chances of these voltages to go much more higher level. Fine. So load side capacitors can magnify these transient over voltages at the end user bus for a certain low voltage capacitors and step down transformer sizes. What do I mean by that? No, see, there is you have a capacitor at the utility end which need to be energized. But with the energization of the capacitor bank at the utility end may affect or will affect your capacitors at the end user. At the end user equipment, and even there also you have a capacitor to improve the power factors, fine. So those capacitor there also end equipment also gets affected with energization of your capacitor bank at the utility end. So what happens? We will be seeing in the few slides also how does it affect, you know, the load side capacitors can magnify this transient. So how does it do? We will see that. So load side capacitors can magnify this transient over voltages at the end user bus because your end user bus are basically of lower voltage, fine. So that you can go up to a low voltage capacitor and you use a different size of step down transformers. But you know, that is not a best solution. It is not the very best solution of using a low voltage capacitors or step down transformers of various sizes. So what is the solution? We will see it in next few slides, right? So now what happens? The voltage magnification of capacitor bank switching, how it happens. Now you see over here, this is your feeder, this is your utility end. And here I have a capacitor which need to be energized. And this energization of the capacitor at the utility end will affect the capacitor which is connected at the load end. Fine. So now in between these two, what do I have? I have a transformer. Fine. So what is happening over here? So what we are talking about here is the one solution which has been advised is either you go for a low voltage capacitor over here, or you go for a step down transformer size. You reduce the way you take the different size of step down transformers and just see how can you magnify this capacitor bank switching. So now the voltage magnification at customer capacitor due to energization capacitor on the utility system. So what we see is, so this is something is happening at your utility end as the capacitor is turned on. And due to the turning on of the capacitor at the utility end, you can see the effect of the capacitor which is connected at your end user. Fine. So this is what you are seeing, the impact of turning on the capacitor at the utility end. So now what we see is, so this is a frequency as a switching frequency at the utility end. And this is a natural frequency of the customer resonance circuit. So this is for the customer end, this is what you are seeing is. So the voltage magnification is possible when both the frequency matches. So that is the mode of it is possible. So now if you look at this figure, why these reactors are connected in series? So we'll see that why this, because they help in magnifying the voltage at the end equipment. So we'll see that. Now what happens, the transient over voltage at the end user side may reach as high as 3 to 4 per unit on the low voltage bus under these conditions with potentially damaging consequences. That's what I told you. If there are chances that the switching of the utility end will, and if your capacitor switching is not, if the capacitor bank is not properly grounded, then the overshoot can go up to 4 per unit, which is pretty high and enough to spoil the equipments at the end user level. So for that, magnification of utility capacitor switching at the transients at the end user location occurs over a wide range of transformers and capacitor sizes. So resizing the customer's power factor correction capacitors or stepping down the transformer is therefore usually not a practical solution. That is what I told you exactly. You want to resize your, at your customer and you want to resize, that means you want to use a low voltage capacitor or you want to work on the step down of transformers sizes. It's not a very practical solution. You know, it requires altogether design, altogether different design, but that's not a optimal solution which you can get. So what is the one solution which has been suggested is to control these kind of over voltages which is happening at the utility end by using the synchronous closing breakers or switches with pre-insertion resistors. So these are the two. Synchronous closing breakers are nothing but just like your circuit breakers. So they have to synchronize with your the turning on time of the capacitors, or we can use some kind of switches which has already a pre-insertion resistor, which will help in reducing the magnitude of these transient voltages, right? Because as we are telling, the transient voltages can be very high, which can go up to 4 per unit if the grounding is not proper. So in that case, we need to do certain, precautions or certain protective systems which can, or certain magnification process which can reduce this voltages to a reduced level. And so at the customer location, high energy surge resistors can be applied. Yeah, now I'm talking about, previously I just told about the solution at the utility level. So what is the solution at the utility level is you add a synchronous breakers or add a switches which is having a pre-insertion resistors. But when I come to as a utility level end, when I come to the end user level end, so when you are at the end user level, there you can put a high surge arrestors, put a lightning arrestors, which we talk in other terms. So they are called as a high energy surge arrestors, can be applied to limit this high transient voltage magnitude at the customer bus. So from customer end, we are going to use this kind of surge arrestors. So now this is a typical graph which is shown for a step down transformer, which is having a 1500 kVA, and for different low voltage capacitor sizes, how does the surge arrestors works or they magnify the transients are shown. It is important that the arrestors can only limit the transients to the arrestors to protected level. That's what I've explained to you. They will help you to you know, bring the voltage to the protected level. So these will work for approximately 1.8 times. Now, if you have any sensitive device which is below this particular range, then this phenomena will not, this particular process will not work out. You know, so this may not be sufficient to protect sensitive electronic equipment that might only have a withstand capability of 1.75 per unit. So for proper coordination, it is important to carefully evaluate. So it's very important before you do anything that evaluate the whole process, whether it's really going to work out or not. So you need to evaluate the withstand capability of the sensitive equipment used in applications where these transients can occur. So very important, you need to design a proper withstand capability of all the equipments where the chances of occurring these transients are more. Fine. So there are another mean. The another mean of limiting this voltage magnification transients are to convert these, you know, the convert the end user power factor correction banks to harmonic filters. So how does this harmonic filters will help? Okay. So what happens when you add an inductance in series with a power factor correction bank? So you are basically an add-on. Okay. It's not that you're replacing, it's basically an add-on. So when an inductance in series with the power factor correction bank will, what will happen? Will decrease the transient voltage at the customer bus at the acceptable level. Sorry, to the acceptable level. So basically, you add that inductor in series with the capacitor bank, it will help in reducing the voltage level. And this has a lot of other benefits. So these benefits include the correction for the displacement power factor, controlling the harmonics distortions. Then third thing is you're limiting the concern magnitude of the capacitor switching transient. So you, this is, will give you all the benefits which is needed for the system to run healthy. So it is frequently more economical to place line reactors in series with the drives to block the high frequency magnification transients. Fine. So it's basically these reactors which we are talking in terms of inductors, they are connected in series with the drives. Right now, the, so far we are talking about only a lightning, we were only talking about the capacitor switching. So capacitor switching is nothing but an oscillatory behavior. So that is an oscillatory transient. Now we are going to talk about an impulsive transient, which is nothing but your lightning. So we all are very much aware about that what happens when the lightning strikes a particular point. Fine. So it is a very powerful source of impulsive transient. So now this strike can happen anywhere in your throughout system. Fine. It can strike the conductor at the primary side. It can strike at the secondary end load side, or it can strike anywhere. As the different point over here, it shows it is striking at the primary face of the conductor. It is striking somewhere at the, you know, the another structure which is near to that, or the secondary phase. It can strike anywhere. So everywhere it depends how your grounding is being done. Fine. So you can see the transformer side. This is what you are seeing is the surge arrestor, or you call it as a lightning arrestor. So you know the perfect place or the perfect to put these lightning arrestors, or surge arrestor, is always before and after your transformers, because transformers are the most costliest equipment which you have, one of the most costliest equipment which you have in the power system. So you need to protect this transformers from this lightning strikes. So for that, usually it is an before the transformer and after this transformer, there will be a lightning arrestors. So these lightning arrestors, if the lightning strikes at the primary side of the transformer, then the usually it will take a path. So you can see if it is striking at the conductor end, so you can see that the tower should be properly grounded. So this is the arrow mark for shown for this grounding point. Because what does this shows? Because you have to provide the least resistance path so that the lightning, the current can flow through the least resistance path and go to the ground. Fine. So this is the path it will take if it falling over here. If it strikes over here, if it strikes somewhere at the primary of the transformer, you, it will definitely take the path of the lightning arresters, which is grounded again. So we call it is an arrestor grounding. Fine. So here the arrestor will be providing a grounding. If the strike, if the lightning strike happens somewhere at the secondary side of the transformer, then this is the dotted line. Whatever the dotted lines are represented or shows the path for your grounding. So this is a certain structure. It can be a building, it can be in any other industry. And if there also the highest peak, because the tendency of the strike is always at the highest point. So whenever it does so, we have to keep it in my mind that it should be grounded properly. So usually also the surge arrestors are placed at the highest point so that they are grounding has been done properly. So what happens if there a grounding is not done properly by any means at the primary end, then there are chances that these may occur. This phenomena may be also represented at the secondary end. Fine. And how does it come towards the secondary end? We will see it, because there will be always a capacitance effect between these two windings. There will be always a capacitance, which we call it as an interwinding. So there will be effect of interwinding capacitance between the two windings, and which will provide, which will give a path for a high frequency waves. So, you know, so there is a tendency of the, if the grounding is not done at the primary end, then it can flow to the secondary end and reach to the load and spoil the load equipments. I hope it's clear. It's very simple, because lightning logic itself is very simple, though it is of a very high magnitude. But understanding for the lightning effect is not of such high magnitude. Okay. So the most obvious conduction path occurs during a direct strike to a phase wire. So that's most commonly seen either on the primary or the secondary side of the transformer. So these can generate a very high overvoltages, but some analysts question whether this is the most common way that lightning surges enter load facility and that cause damages. So there's always an argument whether the load equipment which faces the load equipment which sees this kind of surges, that is due to the lightning strike at the primary end of the transformer or at the secondary end of the transformer. Fine. So very similar transient overvoltages can be generated by lightning currents flowing along ground paths. I already told you that is a, it all depends how your grounding has been done. So if there is any loophole at the primary end, definitely it will come towards your secondary end. Note there can be numerous paths for lightning currents. Fine. So there are there absolutely, if your grounding is not done properly, then definitely the current knows how to flow to the ground. So whichever path it will find a least resistance path, it will follow that and reach to the ground or wherever nearby the equipments. Fine. Note that strikes to the primary phase are conducted to the ground circuits through the arrestors on the service transformers. I've already explained a direct strike to a phase conductor generally causes line flash over near the strike. So which you have seen a lot of videos, YouTube videos, if the lightning strikes on the conductor or any nearby point, you can just see those flash overs. So not only does this generate an impulsive transients, but it causes a fault, you know, and this fault may lead to your voltage sag or interruptions. Fine. So these lightning surges can be conducted a considerable distance along utility lines and causes multiple flashovers at the pole. It may happen at certain point, but the effect you can see some other point too. So the interception of the impulse from the phase wire is fairly straightforward if the properly installed surge arrestors are used. So very important, proper locations of the surge arrestors and the grounding of the complete utility section as well as the load section equipments. Depending on the effectiveness of the ground along the surge current path, some of the current may find its way into the load apparatus, which I already. Lightning does not have to actually strike a conductor to inject impulse into the power system. That's what I told. It need not to inject, it need not to strike on the conductor. It may strike somewhere else, but the impact may be seen on the conductor. Fine. So lightning may also simply strike the ground near the facility, causing the local ground reference to rise considerably. So wherever it strikes the ground potential at that point, you can see it has increased. So this may force currents along the grounded conductors into a remote ground, possibly passing near the sensitive load apparatus. Very simple to understand, nothing is difficult. So here you can see, this is what I was talking about, that if there is a lightning strike at the primary end of your transformer and the grounding is not done properly, you can see that these are the capacitors which are not physically present, you know. These are not physically present into your system. These are the effect. You see the effect of transients when you say talk about a transient, a capacitance effect from the transformer to the ground, you are basically call them as a stray capacitance. When you see the capacitance between the two windings, you call them as an intercapacitance, interwinding capacitance. Okay. So we see that many investigators in this field postulates that the lightning surge enters load from the utility system through the interwinding capacitance of the service transformer, as shown in the figure. So you can see that the effect is over here, but you can see at the secondary end too. So the concept is that the lightning impulse is so fast that the inductance of the transformer windings block the first part of the wave from passing through the turns ratio. So it's able to stop only the first part of the wave. However, the interwinding capacitance may offer a ready path for the high frequency surges. So the preliminary part will be, you know, controlled by the inductance of the transformer, but the high frequency surges will be passed through by this interwinding resistors. So this can permit the existence of a voltage on the secondary terminal. So that is the reason you see the striking on the primary side and the effect on the secondary terminal, and that is much higher than what the turns ratio of the windings would suggest. See, this interwinding, if you have to control, you have to minimize the effect of this interwinding capacitance, what you need to do it, either you reduce the turns ratio or this interwinding voltages need to be reduced. Fine. So that's how you can control the voltage to surpass from the primary towards the secondary. So now here one particular another example has been taken where lightning impulse bypassing the service transformer. So lightning arresters are bypassing the service arresters through the ground connections. So what is happening? Many times a longer impulse, which is sometimes oscillatory, is observed. You remember these are basically impulsive. Okay, so they are unidirectional. But sometimes it has seen that the effect of them is oscillatory and it is observed on the secondary end. So you can see that oscillatory, something has happened at the primary end, but the effect is seen on the secondary end, which nature is of oscillatory. So when there is a strike to a utility primary end distribution, striking is happening at the primary end, but the secondary end oscillation has been observed in this particular format. So this is likely due to not the capacitive effect coupling through the service transformer, but to the conduction around the transformer through the grounding system. So how your grounding system is, so this is not happening due to, because previous case, what we have seen that if there is a lightning strike at the primary end, secondary end is getting affected, the secondary end equipments are getting affected due to the high frequency, which has passed due to the this interwinding capacitance. Now, what we are talking about that it's not the role of the interwinding capacitance which is transferring that to the secondary end, but the service transformer around the transformer, the grounding system, which has been done. So instead of going through that, the grounding system, it goes for the transformer ground or it goes to the other. It finds a different path to flow. Fine. So if it is not proper, your primary arresters is not proper. So it is finding a different path and going towards the load section and showing such kind of oscillatory behavior. This is a particular problem if the load system offers a better grounding. Yes, why it is happening so? Because I told you very clearly, the current understand only a simple language that you offer me a low resistance path, I will take that path. So that means your load grounding is offering a much more lower resistance path than your primary site or the transformer grounding or the utility grounding, fine. So this kind of problem will occur when your load grounding is much better than your utility grounding or your transformer grounding. So what is the chief power quality problems with lightning stroke currents entering the ground system? So what is the main problem? I have highlighted. So you should remember these two points. when your lightning with your lightning strike enters the grounding system, what is the main power quality problem we see? Number one, it raises the potential of the ground, you know, so they raise the potential of the local ground above other grounds in the vicinity by several kilovolts compared to other ground. Obviously, when such a high current absorbs in that particular grounding system, obviously the potential of that grounding system will be much more higher than the nearby grounding system. Sensitive electronic equipment that is connected between the two ground references, such as computer connected to the telephone system through a modem, can fail when subjected to the lightning surge voltages. Fine, I hope it's clear. It's pretty clear. The sentence is very cleanly written. So they induce high voltages in this. That's what we are talking about. They induce a very high voltages in the phase conductors as they pass through cables on the way to a better ground, because they'll keep searching you. If the lightning strikes on your conductor, which is very common, and if it strikes on the conductor, we see a flashover, and that particular high current search for the path which goes towards the ground, and whichever path gives its least resistance, it will follow that particular path. As simple as that. Fine. So, okay. So with this, Vipesh, I hope you have enjoyed today's lecture. It is very practical and very common. We have seen the different types of the basic two types of most important types of transients which are happening into the power system. That is your lightning and due to the capacitor switching. I hope you have enjoyed. So if you have enjoyed and you have understood, so the most interesting part of my lectures is the quiz. So I hope you will answer along with me when I ask you a certain question. So let us see the first question. Transient phenomena last in power system for a period ranging from, yes, guys, I have continuously telling that answer from beginning of the lecture. So can you please answer that? Think for a second. Okay. I hope most of you, those who are listening to the lecture very carefully, you know the answer. It is from few nanoseconds to few milliseconds. Fine. So transients occur for a very short duration, and that's why the name is called as transients. The overvoltage surges in power system may be caused by, yes, guys, what are the reason for these overvoltage surges? I told you the two main are there, but the major, the basic reasons may be a capacitor switching, then yes, lightning, then resonance, then there may be any type of fault, short circuit faults which are happening, which increase the voltage or the current into the of the system. Fine, but out of these, the two main reasons are of the transients are here. That is basically the transient over voltages are due to capacitor switching and lightning. Okay. So next, in a power system, lightning arresters. Okay, in a power system, lightning arresters are used to protect the electrical equipment against what? In a power system, lightning arresters are used to protect the electrical equipment against what? I know all of you know the answer. For the over voltages due to indirect lightning strike, because that is what your whole lecture is all about. In an extra high voltage overhead transmission line, okay, earth wire is provided to protect the line against, I repeat, in an extra high voltage overhead transmission line, earth wire is provided to protect the line against what? The lightning strikes. Fine. So you wanted to protect your system from the lightning strikes. That's how you provide those earth wire. During faults in a power system, severe overvoltages are produced with neutral. Complete the sentence. I repeat, during faults in a power system, severe overvoltages are produced with neutral. What? Neutral should be connected in a star fashion, neutral should be connected in delta fashion, or neutral, there's no neutral point, or I say neutral is isolated. What may be the reason? Okay. Yes, of course, yes, if the neutral is isolated, fine. Capacitors are used to provide reactive power to dash and supports the dash on the system? What is the answer? Think we are explaining you what is the need of capacitor first of all in the system. First of all, we have to understand why do I have to use reactors, capacitors in the line. Only when we know the reason behind why we need them, then only we can understand what do we do, why they are used, and then we can find out how to use them, you know. So if I know the capacitors are used to provide the reactive power, basically to do what? You know, to basically to correct or improve the power factor. So basically the line says the capacitors are used to provide reactive power to improve or correct the power factor and supports what? If you improve the power factor, what will happen? Your system voltage will be better. So what happened? It supports the voltage on the system. Fine. So this answer. Here I have a question. What is the drawback of using capacitors? You know the benefit of the capacitor. Just now the last question talks about the benefit of the capacitor. You need a capacitor in your capacitor banks in your system to improve the power factor and to maintain the system voltage to the great extent. What is the drawback? That also we have covered in our today's lecture. The drawback is, yes, correct. The drawback is these capacitors inject a oscillatory transients. They have yield oscillatory transients when they are turned on or when they are switched. What is the common problem faced related to utility capacitors switching over voltages? What is the common factor? I was continuously telling you during the lecture that something happened at the industry end. Remember, please recall. Yes. What is the common problem faced related to the utility capacitor switching over voltages? Yes, fine. What is the answer? That daily they occur at the same time. You know, this has been preset. The time has been preset and daily at the same time it turned on. So appear at nearly the same time each day. So that is the common problem faced at the utility end. Overshoot will generate a transient between 1 and 2 per unit depending on. I repeat, the overshoot will generate a transient between 1 to 2 per unit depending on what? That means I'm talking about my system. Whenever the transient will happen, switching action will happen, the voltage may go from 1 per unit to 2 per unit or 3 per unit or 4 per unit if the grounding is not proper. But it depends. Yes, it does depend on grounding, but it also depends on damping constant. Okay, so what is your system damping? Okay, what is your system grounding? So these are the reason that how these voltages can be more and more high. How the transient over voltages at the utility capacitor is controlled? We have discussed how it can be controlled. Please recall how these over voltages can be controlled with the help of a synchronous closing breakers or a switch with pre-insertion resistors at the utility end. What about at the load end? What about the load end? This is the solution for the utility end. What is the solution for the load end? Is that is my quiz, next quiz. Did I put that? Yes, I have done that. How at the customer location, the transient voltage magnitude can be limited with the help of surge arrestors. Good. With the help of surge arrestor. So you put it in your customer bus and you will find the magnitude is reduced. Fine. Or to convert end user power factor correction banks to harmonic filters. Fine. Okay. So with this, our today's lecture ends. And I hope, my dear friends, you like today's lecture. Please take care of yourself. We'll meet in the next lecture. Thank you. Bye.